This brings us to the next session, which will be our final plenary, and the title is Bringing Higher Education and Employment Together. So we will have practical ways forward. And again, as I said, to a long but extremely fruitful day where much has been exchanged and learned. But as I said, it's not over yet. And in this final session, we are going to bring various strands of the day together. And our lineup of very experienced and eloquent speakers will share their insights on key themes, key recommendations, as well as some very innovative projects that bring employment and education together in exciting ways. And just looking at the lineup, I think we are going to start with Pavati Rugram, and please do excuse me if I'm mispronouncing the name. The first on our lineup is Professor Pavati Rugram. Over to you.
Great. Thanks ever so much. And I'm going to first say huge thanks to all the different speakers today. I've attended most of the day and it's been an incredible journey. It's lovely to see the knowledge, the energy and the vision of all the participants here today. And I have learned so much. So I want to do two things. The first thing is to talk about four aspects that I thought were really interesting and some things that could be pushed along a little further. And then move on in the next sort of 2.5 minutes or so to thinking about the challenges for the education employment nexus. So to begin with four sort of points from today, one of the things that was really important for me is destinations, the difference between destinations, nations and cities, institutions and platforms. All of those really came out very strongly as a spatial characteristics. And I have to say I'm a geographer. So it was really interesting. But what was also interesting is how the question that I leave you with is, how do you learn across those differences between nations and cities? One of the things around space, which was slightly perhaps not really developed, was the point about the differences between different, countries from which people had left. We heard a lot of refugee voices, which was just fantastic. But on the other hand, perhaps we need to think a little bit more about how that affects where people come from, might affect the reception, both in terms of employment and education, because these things come with classed, gendered, and racialized differences, both in sending country and in receiving country. So that's my first point, space. The second was about temporalities, and I was really interested to see the status and shifts between asylum seekers and refugees, the time that you wait before you get refugee status, and all those spaces in between. And of course, what we don't know much about is what happens to those who don't get asylum, and what do we offer them? There's also lots of things around temporalities, about delays, early phase, progression, interruptions, which really came out to me. The third thing that I thought was really fascinating about the day was the whole life perspective and the importance of speaking across education and employment. What can education learn from employment and vice versa? How does housing or lack of it affect employment? So all these questions of different phases and aspects of your life, how do you take a whole life perspective to these issues? And the fourth was about intersectionality. Because refugee, like we heard through several times during the day, is not the only identity or the identification that people have. There are many others. Age at which people came, their current age. Is this a university, or is education or employment that of a second chance? Disabilities, gender and sexuality. These are things that really completely intersect to influence and shape the experiences of entry, progression, and actually a sense of achievement in that employment education nexus. And what's important here is to think about how we then not just allow people to enter, but how we invite people to enter. What is it that takes, what has to be done in order to extend that, that as an invitation? What is the gesture of hospitality? And I think that's, so what then are the challenges for the education employment nexus? For me, one of the things that I've worked on with regard to, if, for instance, some aspects of the decolonization, the university as well, is gearing. Yeah, is the importance of familiarizing students, staff, other students to the cohort, right? To what does refugee or what does migrant, what does the what are the experiences of a migrant that really influence their ongoing experience as a student, right? So and to do this prior to students entering into the education workplace, education or workplace, so that we think of this as a two-way process, not for students or for employees to integrate, but institutions to use this as an opportunity to learn and adapt to a changing world. So we go beyond the charity model to have a give and take model and to recognize the richness of the 21st century world readiness that actually having refugees and migrants within amongst the non-refugee populations brings to any institution. And I think this is really important to see that actually this is not a charitable form. So that would be my second point there. The third point is there are different forms of learning. And I think this is really crucial. A lot of learning is seen, is like, for instance, through NARIC and through accreditation, is seen as accredited learning. But of course, there's a varieties of experiential learning, as we heard from so many speakers today. And actually, how do you take on board and recognize experiential learning? This is a challenge which both entrepreneurs and educationalists share. And I think here there is something for us to come together to think about how do we make learning much more integrative to and much less dependent on assimilation, like reading or accreditation. And the fourth point here is about communities of practice. And we have many different communities of practice in which are similar, but also different across this nexus. The one-to-one, which is crucial for mentoring, and we see this, for instance, in tutor relations and education. But also communities of education, and these communities of education can be hybrid, because as things go both simultaneously online and offline, what kinds of communities might be willing to support, for instance, with language, who are outside the notion of the community, either an educational community or an employment community, the wider communities, and how do you enroll them into that education employment nexus? Then there's something about intermediaries, which I think is really important, because as we again heard today, is that what is the role of intermediaries and who should be good intermediaries? Another point about communities of practice is community relations. There are others from the same country, for instance, who might already be in the country. What is their role? And what are the problems and prospects of bringing them on board, given that so many refugees are coming from areas of conflict? And I want to end by saying that this is a manifesto. And I think it is important to do all of this with and for a sense of justice and a sense of rights, because this has to be about entitling refugees and not just supporting them. It is a need to actually enable that form of entitlement. What can and will be, will that entitlement look like? Because that for us is the common ethical response across the education and employment sectors. And thanks so much to everyone for really giving us such a wonderful spread of talks today. Thank you.
Well, great. Well, thank you very much, Professor Pavati Rugram of the Geography and Migration at the Open University. Great insights, lots of thought for thought, or food for thought. My next guest and next speaker is Simon Tender, who is the head of Skills and Innovation at at the Open University. Over to you, Simon.
Okay, thank you. There should be a... So if I just share my desktop, hopefully you can now see that.
Simon, your slide deck's already on the on the screen. Just take control.
Okay. Yep, should be fine.
Cool.
That's fine. So what I really wanted to cover briefly, because I appreciate it's probably been a very fruitful day, but equally a very warm day for everyone, was to talk very briefly about some of the employer engagements that we've had that are really looking to sort of go beyond that standard corporate sort of sponsorship of their employees, and equally how applicable some of these may be or are already helping refugees, but equally could be sort of food for thought to actually go and expand this area. Interestingly, just listening to some of the sessions today, we're really sort of talking around this sort of area of connection, and particularly that common theme of how do we make people aware of both groups, and sort of particularly one of the speakers in the last session, sort of how do we acclimatize refugees coming into the country. And I know that we've done some work around sort of OU resources in that area, but arguably that could be expanded, and some of the areas that I cover now may actually go through that. But I wanted to talk a little bit about the Uber Learning as a Benefit program. So approximately 18 months ago, we set up a relationship with Uber, where they were looking for a program to help their sort of best drivers. These are the drivers that are driving for them, primarily as doing it as a full-time job. And they wanted to provide free higher education. So in effect, Uber have set up a scheme where they pay all the tuition fees and allow their driver or that driver to choose any Open University undergraduate qualification and study for that, and Uber will pay for the full degree tuition cost. What makes the program more interesting is that should the driver not want to take up that program directly, they can pass that credit on to a family member. And so what is happening is that family member could be a spouse or a partner, could be a child, could be a sibling. And we have been running this since January last year. It's running as a two-year pilot. And currently we're at over 800 students are on program. Approximately 25-30% of those programs are family members. The bulk of them are drivers themselves. What's equally really interesting is that the TMA, our sort of measure of their performance as they go through those degree courses for this group, is significantly higher for this cohort than for the sort of standard Open University student. Uber have been so pleased with the program so far that they've recently just expanded it out to Uber Eats couriers. And this probably represents an investment for the company over the couple of years of around sort of $4.5 million coming onto that. So what is interesting and the relevance that has to this audience is that when you look at the profile of the Uber drivers, that yes, 90% of them are male. That's not particularly unexpected. But the more interesting factor is 75% of this audience are first generation migrants to the UK. And within that, there are going to be refugees coming in. So some of that migration is from predominantly former or from the EU countries, but equally from further afield as well. And so the Uber demographics of their driver population strongly align to both the Open University's social remit, but equally around some of the challenges to this community as well. Interestingly, of those migrants, 62% already have some form of further qualification beyond secondary education. 30% of them would have a degree. But what we found when we started this this program was we had a very high spike on people studying law. And the reason being that many of these people had already attained a law degree in their host country, in their birth country, but obviously could not practice because they didn't have a UK law qualification, could not really work or practice within that field of law. And so they've now moved on, I think, within the first couple of uptakes or first presentation of the course, we had over 100 Uber from the Uber community taking introduction to law. So this is a program, I think what's equally interesting about it is Uber have gone beyond just paying money for this program, but are using it very much as part of their own corporate social responsibility. They are looking to increasingly help the university or build links with the university in many different ways. And just on the presentation, if you wanted to know more about these courses, is or the site, the main site can be viewed just at the links there. There's little introductory films and equally some white papers on learning as a benefit. I think what it shows is that increasingly employers, or the more sort of forward-thinking employers, are looking beyond just training their staff. So what Uber are not trying to do here is build or is to make better drivers. What they're recognizing is that people drive with Uber as a transient business many times as they come into a country before they settle into a more sort of significant career. And what Uber wanted to do was build a scheme that helped retain their better drivers, but equally prepared them for their future career moves within the country. So it's quite forward thinking. We do have situations now where somebody is driving for Uber in the UK, but they're actually sponsoring their brother who is still in their birth country to do an Open University degree. So it's helping to break down that traditional view that the recipient or the beneficiary of the training has to directly be the employer themselves. So that was one program which I thought may be of interest. The second program is more is less of a commercial program, but more around our social remit, is that we've recently been doing a lot of work with the Department of Works and Pensions, and we have built a curation of open learn courses which are really around job seekers and other universal credit claimants, so people that are quite often looking to upskill, but I think more significantly is many of these people already have significant work skills. They may not have any recognition for those existing skills. So this isn't about formal accredited education. This is more about utilizing the resources we have available within Open Learn to allow people to gain certification, to gain digital badging, which they can share with their with potential employers. They can put on their LinkedIn profiles, their CVs. So we started off working with a single JCP job center. And this, over the pandemic, we've rolled that out as a full program across all 750 job centers. And now, and I think here's where it becomes more relevant, is we are looking, whilst that was a general offering to all universal credit claimants. We're now looking to target particularly specific sectors. So the first one we're doing is looking at young people, but I think we would also be open to looking at other disadvantaged groups moving forward. So that was really, you know, I appreciate this has been a long day and this presentation. Should you require any other information on this, please just email me or contact me. And the links for the Open Door to Success programs are shown there. That was really what I wanted to cover in this very short presentation.
Well, great. Thank you very much, Simon, for sharing these two wonderful examples when it comes to kind of innovative ways to employment. So thank you very much for this. And my next speaker is Sean Summers-Rees from Swansea City of Sanctuary. So over to you, Sean.
I'd like to say I'm from Swansea, City of Sanctuary. I was one of the founders, but I'm actually talking in my role as the Chief Officer of City of Sanctuary UK. But before I start, I just wanted to say a big thank you to Swansea City of Sanctuary and Open University for this wonderful conference today. And a very happy birthday. I'm so proud of Swansea and I'm so glad that I was there at the start of the journey and I'm here today to celebrate our achievements. So thank you. What a fantastic way to start off Refugee Week for me as well. I'm just going to quickly reflect really on the day and talk about what, you know, what the practical ways forward. And I suppose Ahmed started this off by talking about people's commitment and the Welsh Government echoed that commitment. And I think that's just firstly, as a starting point, that's what we need. We need more commitment from organisations and individuals to realise the City of Sanctuary vision, but everyone's vision of Wales becoming a nation of sanctuary. And I think only through in order to eliminate the barriers to employment and education, the only way to do that is to build that wider movement for welcome. We can put in place as many initiatives, as many services, but without having the opportunity for people to feel safe to go and to places where they find people who welcome them and understand them, that is, you know, that has to be a wider goal. But we have excellent opportunities, I think, from today to look at how we can work further with businesses, how we can work with universities, we can work through our colleges and libraries and theatres of sanctuary to make that vision a reality. And I think what's come out of today, most importantly, is that collaboration between the third sector through the public sector. And we have the opportunity of using, you know, the Sanctuary Awards, the Business of Sanctuary, the University of Sanctuary to forge those links and to bring people together to collaborate and work together. And the other thing that I think I've been reflecting on as we've gone through the day is, you know, is very much kind of our theory of change, of how we can think change can happen. And let's go back to the theme for Refugee Week. You know, we cannot walk alone, and very much within our theory of change is that you know, we can have to build relationships of solidarity. So social contact is the way of ensuring that people seeking sanctuary and people from the receiving community can build relationships and of solidarity, and also work towards kind of the vision of welcome. And we know there's a lot of academic research with regards to social contact, and that underpins, you know, our assumptions that we can change public attitudes by building a movement of and being together in solidarity. But what has struck me most, and you know, I just think was wonderful, is to hear from people with lived experience, for them to lead the sessions, for them to be forefront in our discussions. And that's, you know, the way forward for us is to, as a friend of mine always says, listen, learn from me. And he is so right, and Mishka's not one that you argue with. So I think going forward, you know, that for me has been a really good aspect of today. And if we can build that within all of our streams work in terms of our schools work, our colleges work, and our universities, I think that is one of the takeaways from today. But I think what we need to think about is our streams and awards work being a really good strategic tools. And the reason why I'm really keen to push these awards is that, you know, City of Sanctuary does not own them. We are willing and we really want people to take those initiatives forward with us in collaboration. I'm really pleased in Wales now to see a really active Schools of Sanctuary network developing with lots of engagement by various third sector organisations as well as local authorities. So it's an exciting time, I think, in terms of our schools work, our universities work as well. You know, I think since we've had the Cardiff Met achieve the award and then the University of South Wales, we have seen fantastic engagement from other universities, and I'm so excited to hear about the Open University's work and Swansea University, who I met with just before the pandemic, and you know, I think they were very close to being in a position to apply for that award, and using our key principles of learning what it means to be seeking a sanctuary, both in general but specifically what that means in a context of higher education. It's just so invaluable, and to go through that process of embedding that within your university, within your specific context, is going to ensure that people seeking sanctuary are welcomed. And then sharing that vision in events like today so that we can grow more and more in places of safety and sanctuary for all. So I just wanted to finish by saying thank you so much for the opportunity to speak. It's been great to celebrate the first day of Refugee Week here with you all today, and to celebrate the achievements of Swansea City of Sanctuary. And I'm going to be very short, for which makes a change, because I know it's been a really long day. So thank you, everyone.
Wonderful. Thank you very much, Sean, for your reflections. Really great insights. And we're going to move to our next speaker. So last but not least, our next speaker is Sibu Mawembe from the African Community Centre. So over to you, Sibu.
Can you see me?
Yes, we can see you. We can hear you.
Okay, that's absolutely fine. So my name is Sibu Sisiwembembe, and I'm the general manager for the African Community Center. We provide specialist counseling services to forced migrants. We provide one-to-one counseling, and we provide interpreters for those counseling services to people who need language support. So today's employment conference has been very inspiring for me and very insightful. It's been very educative, and it's wonderful to hear the commitment from our Welsh minister, our Minister Jane Hart, on the work which the Welsh Government is already doing and the amazing work which is happening across the board. So for me, drawing on my personal lived experience, I resonate with a lot of obstacles and challenges which have been raised today, having been stuck in limbo for 7 years. And I also resonate with experiences of the forced migrants, which we support at the African Community Centre. So I would like to borrow from the refugee theme, from the words of Dr. Martin Luther King. He said, "We cannot walk alone. As we walk, we must continue to make that pledge that we shall always march ahead." So everything which has the solutions which have come out of this conference is really showing that we are marching ahead. We are not where we want to be as Wales, but we are certainly not where we used to be. Because when I look from when I was an asylum seeker myself to how things have improved and changed, I can certainly see that Wales is moving ahead, as the words of Dr. Martin Luther King. And as we march ahead, for me, the things which have really resonated with me today is to promote integration from day one. So promoting that integration from day one for people when they come in to know that this is a city of sanctuary, we are welcome, and Wales is a nation of sanctuary. There are different opportunities and having that support network. For myself, I draw on to that. I have had so much support. I have had mentors who have been there to mentor me. And now I am an entrepreneur. I'm a life coach. I'm a motivational speaker, a Zumba instructor, and I'm also a Big Idea Welsh role model. I have named all this just to show you that what a person can achieve when they have the right support in place. They can go forward, they can march forward and thrive in their dreams and aspirations. So, and the other thing which has really resonated with me today is the skills recognition, to recognize those skills prior to people coming here, to be able to have the fast track courses, which we enable people to practice in their field. And also a big one for me is the meaningful employment, like what Stephanie has said in the morning. It's not just about providing employment, it's about meaningful employment. I draw on my experience. I started off as a volunteer with an organization called Bowser, which support victims of domestic abuse. I started doing administration work. They didn't give me just tasks to shred papers. They actually trained me. They gave me tasks, which meant I could do finance, I could do all sort of things. And I built my confidence by doing that. I built my skill set by doing meaningful things, meaningful tasks. So providing the meaningful employment has really resonated with me today. And I call on all stakeholders who are here today that as we are making this pledge to march forward, we need to be able to provide that meaningful employment. And also, the other thing is about commissioning those contracts, giving people the chance, the opportunity to showcase what they can do. I know there's a lot of initiatives which are going on the ground, mentoring and all the schemes, but people actually need that practical opportunity to showcase what they have been mentored to do, what they have learned in college, what they have learned in university. If you are to go to the university and you end up not using what you went to university to study, and you end up just doing a general job which doesn't match your skill set, that does not help. So let us give that opportunity, stakeholders to give that opportunity, employers to give that opportunity to force migrants. And indeed, I know we cannot walk alone. Wales can never walk alone in becoming a nation of sanctuary and a thriving economy. I call on everybody here today to pledge that walk, to walk in solidarity and to value the skills and attributes of forced migrants and to bring them on board, to give them that foot on the door. Thank you very much, Dioch.
Well, thank you very much for such a compelling intervention from Cebu, really very strong, very powerful, particularly when you look at that, you know, combined with the personal experiences, which makes it quite compelling. And with that, I think this brings me to our very final kind of remarks. And I'd like to invite Professor Alan Tanu and also Marie from the Open University for reflections and insights. I think you're muted, Alan, so if you could just unmute yourself. Yep.
Okay. I've been asked to do like a vote of thanks, really, I suppose, on behalf of Swansea City of Sanctuary. And there's just a couple of things I wanted to say quickly before I just thank everybody. One of them is that there are so many ideas that have come up today, and a lot of them need following up. They need practical work. And City of Sanctuary is about ideas. It's not about, it's not an organization. It's not a project. It's not up to us to follow everything up. It's not even up to the whole group of organisers, including the Open University, to follow it all up. If WIS was a live event, I would give out, you know, a yellow sticker to everybody. And I would say, please write down at least one, preferably three things which you commit to doing, which are practical outputs, whether it is just, oh, there was a certain person, I must get in touch with them. Well, please do get in touch with them. I know it's hot, you'll probably go away immediately and sit in your garden, and maybe by tomorrow it will have been a distant memory. So please make a commitment to following up. So having said that, I think it is a question of huge thanks to everybody, to all our partners, the universities for the region, the Welsh Refugee Coalition, particularly the Open University with their technical team, as well as all the other OU people who've been involved, everybody who spoke, everybody who facilitated, everybody who attended, even those who attended only for 5 minutes, and everybody who registered and hasn't attended. We do have your names now, so I'm sure there'll be follow-up to all of those people. Please stay in touch. Get in touch by some means or other with Swansea City of Sanctuary if you want to. You can pledge support officially if you want to. And we will be having a kind of more local celebration of everything we've done over 10 years on the 16th of July. And please look out for that. And it would be lovely to see a lot of you there. So thanks to everybody. Wonderful day.
Thank you. Over to you, Marie.
A very big thank you from me and from the Open University to all our participants and contributors. I think we've made a great leap forward in our progress towards applying to become a University of Sanctuary. I would like to just end on a very special note of thanks, because there has been an army of people behind the scenes who've been working for quite a while, several months in fact, organising this conference. Hazel Nixon has been our chief conference liaison and organiser, and has just done amazing work. Hazel, thank you. Babette Oliver and Amy Sharp, we couldn't have done it without you. I know this is beginning to sound like the Oscars or something, but truly, they've been absolutely marvellous. And our conference organising team, Judith, Karis, Funmi and Claudia, they all deserve a special note of thanks, as does Swansea City of Sanctuary, Tanu, and of course, Alan. And thanks to our host of the day, Ahmad Al-Rashid. Ahmed, as always, you've done a terrific job. Thanks to you all. We'll keep in touch. and goodbye.
Well, fantastic. Again, just to say a huge thank you to all and everyone. Thank you for all your time. Thank you for your contributions. Thank you for spending the entirety of the day with us. It means that you are interested, it means that you care, and also it means for many of these people that we are not walking alone, that we are working together. So thank you very much, everyone. And also I'd like to thank the Open University and also Swansea City of Sanctuary for hosting this. And a final word is just to say there's a feedback form. Please let us know how we did today, what we did like us to improve, any kind of feedback. And also there's an option in the feedback form, which if you choose it, you'll hopefully get, you'll receive the report that will follow up hopefully in the near future. Other than this, just to say again, thank you very much, everyone, and enjoy the rest of your day. Thank you.